Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Our first panel, having laid out the scope of the issues with respect to drug and food safety, our second panel is now going to focus on what problems have stood in the way of building what would otherwise be easy and obvious policy prescriptions. Now, easy and obvious, of course, we'll discuss over the course of this next panel how easy and obvious those are. Nonetheless, our first panel, I think, set up some of the issues that we will be talking about, those realities, as Commissioner Hamburg said, that make each and every one of us really vulnerable. Whether they are weak laws, whether they are understaffed regulatory agencies, whether it's diffuse authority, whether it's the complexity of the supply chain or what have you, or just the sheer volume. Peggy Hamburg, I remember several years ago in the thick of the importation debate going up to see a warehouse that FDA has out at JFK Airport where there were literally tens of thousands of seized packages of medications that had come in from other countries, individually imported by Americans, leaving me aghast at what Americans are willing to put into their bodies, for one thing, but secondly, just with a much fuller appreciation of just the scope of the issues. As Lori said, many of them being packages from China and India, as well as other countries. So we're going to be discussing what problems have stood in the way of building these easy and obvious policy prescriptions. And so we're delighted to have back with us once again Commissioner Hamburg in the center there. Also, just to my right here, Howard Zucker, who was formerly with the World Health Organization as Assistant Director General in charge of the so-called Health Technology and Pharmaceuticals Cluster, and also representative of the Director General on Intellectual Property, Innovation, and Public Health. He's now senior advisor in the Division of Global Health and Human Rights at Massachusetts General Hospital. And we're also very happy to have with us Dirceu Barbano, who has been and is director of the National Agency of Sanitary Surveillance in Brazil since 2008, and also as the director chairman of that agency. So with that, let's go to some further definition of the scope of the problems that are standing in the way of building easy and obvious solutions. And again, in the interest of giving some texture to this issue, I've asked each of our panelists to just frame a quick little case study in their memory that surfaces the complexity of the issues involved. So Commissioner Hamburg, let's start with you. What was your favorite experience in this field?
Well, I was asked to speak briefly, very briefly, about a food safety issue, which actually occurred before my tenure as FDA commissioner, but was something that was very much in the papers and carries implications still. And that had to do with an event that was referenced earlier about salmonella contamination of peppers. And it was a complex challenge both in relation to the complexity of the supply chain and agricultural practices and conditions across borders and the nature of the food supply, but also it had to do with the challenges in terms of the underlying science and investigation of foodborne outbreaks. It was an instance where initially, and others in the room were closer to it, so you know I may get the details wrong, but we'll use it as a symbolic example of cases of foodborne illness were reported. Was linked to a certain strain of salmonella. It appeared to be linked to tomato products initially, and some of the cases I think were emerging from Mexican food proprietors where peppers and tomatoes are often served together. But in any case, it was initially believed to be tomatoes, as Dr. Besser mentioned in the first panel. Took quite a toll on the tomato industry as the first warnings went out vis-a-vis the contamination of tomato products. It actually emerged with further epidemiologic investigation and analysis, FDA working closely with CDC, who takes the lead on the outbreak investigation and epidemiology, that there was either cross-contamination between tomatoes and peppers, or that it was actually the peppers, not the tomatoes, that were the cause, and that these were not domestic products, but in fact peppers coming in from Mexico, although peppers and tomatoes were in fact in Mexico being grown on the same farms as well. So it was a very confusing picture about both what the product was and the origin of the contamination. It was eventually linked back to a much more limited and specific set of circumstances in Mexico, the coordination of Mexican authorities and U.S. authorities to remediate the situation, to get the at-risk product off the market, to inform the public, all then fell into place. But it was a prolonged period of trying to determine the source of the foodborne illness with some missteps. It required engagement of domestic food producers and providers, as well as counterparts in Mexico. And at the end of the day, it took a toll on human health. It took a toll on the economic health of several food industries. And even after the outbreak was actually controlled, persistent concerns about the safety and quality of those products more broadly. So it does speak to a number of the important issues before us in terms of how can we work together to prevent problems like that from happening in the first place, as well as how can we harness across sectors and components of government to be able to identify and respond to problems as swiftly as possible, to try to have seamless coordination across borders, and how to also communicate important information to consumers while they are trying to make choices, and also how to better let consumers know when, in fact, the acute episode has been resolved.
And it sounds like there was, at least initially, a lack of cooperation on the scientific side between Mexican authorities and U.S. authorities. Yes? Was that a particular issue?
You know, I don't think that was the case, but I could be wrong. I wasn't involved at the time. I think it was more a complexity of understanding the issues than a failure to cooperate scientifically. There was confusion originally because the initial outbreak investigation suggested the tomatoes, and I'm sure there was a reluctance to engage initially when Mexico thought it was somebody else's problem, and now fingers were being pointed to them.
Denial, as they say, not just being a river in Egypt, as the bad joke goes. So, Howard, in your case, you lived through, on the drug safety side, a version of the events that were alluded to earlier. In the first panel, tell us briefly about those and specifically what obstacles surfaced.
Well, I think that the key issue here that I wanted to raise a little bit was about the impact, which was addressed at the beginning. When I arrived in Geneva, I literally, without exaggeration, I probably wasn't in my office more than a day. And I already received calls from scientists, members from within the WHO, as well as individuals in industry and civil society groups saying, what are we going to do about counterfeit medicines? So from that generated the working group within WHO to talk about this, which ultimately crystallized into the International Medical Products Anti-Counterfeiting Task Force, or IMPACT, which is better known as, which I led for the first 2 years after it was formed. What we did in that point was to try to bring together individuals from all different groups, whether it was FDA, EMEA, other regulatory agencies around the world.
EMA being the European
Medical Agency. Also OECD, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, industry, academia, and public health experts from around the world, and brought them together to say, how do we tackle this? And from that came five different areas, which some of you might know, which involved everything from regulation, legislation, enforcement, technology, and communication. I'll just touch upon each one of those just briefly. On the regulation side, which was led by Alyssa Bernstein from the FDA, who I believe is here today, there was a lot of work done to try to help countries where their regulatory protocols were not as well structured, and to help control some of these issues of counterfeit medicines and working with those teams to put out documents and to work on this area. From that, there was also work between the regulatory agencies and other regulatory team and other teams. At the legislative level, there was a discussion about putting forth a concept or a paper and also a model law. And I like to use that word lightly because I don't want to say that there was an actual law put forth, but something which would be able to be brought back to individual countries, to the different member states, to say this is a document which you could work from within your legal systems to make the issue of someone who has either manufactured a counterfeit drug or has been within that chain of counterfeit medicines basically charged with something more than just an infringement on a patent right, something much more forceful. And if someone died as a result of it, is this sort of more of a homicide, murder, or something equivalent within their legal structure? And then the next part was that you could have the laws written down, you could have the regulatory bodies there, but if there's no way to enforce it. So our feelings were that the enforcement part, which was led by Alain Placon, who's here and will speak later, which was an incredible team of actually looking with World Customs Organizations, Interpol, and other ways to try to tackle the issue of borders and sort of getting rid of some of the porous issues at the borders, and to try to also work with the legislative bodies and others to tackle that part. And then the next part was the issue of technology, and that was led by Harvey Bale, who was from the, at that time, IFPMA, which is the International Federation of Pharmaceutical Manufacturers. And the thought there was that there must be a way to use technologies that are out there to tackle this. And we recognize in many meetings that it has to be tailored to the country. So the concepts of using something like RFID, radio frequency identification, may work in the United States or in Europe or other countries where spending several thousand dollars would be effective, but that's not going to really solve this problem in countries where that's just an exorbitantly high price. So we realized we had to tailor to the individual countries. As a matter of fact, at that meeting, we had a meeting in Prague. I had thrown out the idea of the concept of using cell phones text messaging to actually use a way to validate medical bottles through a randomized number system. And I put that out there at that point. And recently in the last year, I've heard that has now, I'm pleased to say, is out there and gone in other parts of the world. So that is an idea that was out there at that time, or that that I put out there, but others had said could be used and now has been working. And the last part was communication. And the communication issue was, we can have all this in place, but if people don't know about the issues and the messages aren't getting out there, then it's not going to really be effective. And so that team was working on communications and basically sort of addressing and branding these issues. And from that, we generated about 100 people working on this from member states, and there are multiple meetings, and we're moving forward on this. Now, I recognize that the issue, and you asked this before because it was brought up, that the WHO, the issue of counterfeits and impact, has had some criticism at the WHO and the World Health Assembly recently. But I do think that a lot of this is the issue of coupling the issue of counterfeit medicines and intellectual property rights. And I think that we really do need to recognize that these are two separate issues, and there has been a lot of a political component to why these things are coupled. And I guess I would put on my lawyer's hat for a second and say that there's really, you have to look at this from the concept of the legal phrase mens rea, which is there a guilty mind on this? And so if someone's doing something with a guilty mind to move something forward in this supply chain of medicines, then that truly is something which we need to tackle, and in a lot of ways it's counterfeit as we move forward. And lastly, I just would say that if there's a generated effort and resources put forth to move this forward, I think that the impact concept could be pushed forward with those five areas, and we could tackle this problem effectively.
Okay, and you've given us a very nice additional list of issues that need to be transcended. So, Director Barbano, we'd like to hear your brief case study now of a particular issue that surfaced with respect to Brazil's interest in drug and food safety.
Bom dia a todos e todas. Eu vou contar aqui com a minha ajuda, o Tim, que vai falar com vocês como se fosse eu.
Good morning to all. I'm going to ask Tim for his help so that I may speak to you seamlessly.
Eu queria agradecer ao Dr. Richard Hess, presidente do Conselho, a Lauren Garret pelo convite, e também agradecer o Daniel e a Stacy do staff do Conselho que nos ajudaram a chegar muito bem aqui.
I'd like to first of all thank Mr. Richard Hess, president of the Council, as well as Lori Garrett, senior fellow, for her invitation, as well as Daniel and Stacy and members of the staff for bringing us here.
Eu trouxe para essa discussão tema aparentemente simples, envolvendo fruto da região amazônica brasileira chamado açaí.
I brought for this panel a case that is apparently simple, involving a fruit from the Amazon River, Amazon region in Brazil, a fruit called açaí.
Mas eu ouvi muito atentamente o debate anterior, o painel.
I heard with attention to the debate in the previous panel.
E creio que não seria prudente iniciar o estudo de caso sem alguma consideração acerca do tema maior da reunião.
I would like to say that it would not be very prudent of me to start discussion on this theme without first a few considerations about the larger theme of this event.
É inegável que nós temos grande desafio pela frente.
It is undeniable that we have a very major challenge ahead of us.
O mundo muda e passa por momento de transformação econômica muito acentuado.
The world is changing and the economic conditions are changing very rapidly.
Mais países produzem riquezas, distribuem as suas riquezas e mais pessoas consomem produtos fabricados no mundo todo.
More people consume products that are manufactured worldwide.
E essa realidade, de fato, é irreversível. Nós vamos consumir cada vez mais produtos fabricados em diferentes países.
And this reality is irreversible. We will increasingly consume products that are manufactured elsewhere.
É problema visto por lado, mas é solução visto pelo outro. Os países se desenvolvem e distribuem, produzem mais riqueza.
On the one hand, it may be a problem, but on the other hand, it may be seen as a solution, as countries develop and produce other products.
A questão é que todos devemos assumir perspectiva de cuidado com a saúde, de preservação da vida dos seres humanos, colocando saúde e vida antes das questões econômicas.
We need to take on the perspective of health, caring for health, preserving life, and putting health and life above all else.
O Brasil, nos últimos anos, tomou decisão importante de se tornar país mais desenvolvido, mais justo socialmente e economicamente.
Brazil has recently taken the decision to become a more developed country, a more socially just and more economically just country.
O que não significa jamais que queiramos indústrias que fabriquem produtos que coloquem em risco a vida das pessoas.
And that means that we do not want industries that produce goods that put people's lives at risk.
Nós esperamos que a agricultura, a pecuária, produza alimentos de qualidade para o povo brasileiro e que possam ser exportados com segurança.
We expect that our agricultural resources produce products that are of quality for the Brazilian consumers and for exports to other countries.
Esperamos que as indústrias farmacêuticas façam medicamentos que possam ser consumidos e resolvam problemas de saúde no Brasil e no mundo.
We expect our pharmaceutical industries to produce medications that can be consumed, that are of quality, and that can resolve health issues for the Brazilian people.
Preservando a vida e olhando esse brasileiro com o mesmo cuidado que nós teríamos com qualquer outra pessoa de outro país.
And to preserve life and to treat the Brazilian national as we would treat any other person from any other country.
Por isso, essa discussão sobre produtos falsificados, produtos substandards, é de muito interesse do governo brasileiro.
Therefore, this discussion about falsified products and substandard products is of great interest to the Brazilian government.
Mas nós temos que ter a compreensão que os riscos relacionados ao consumo de medicamentos e alimentos não estão localizados apenas nesses produtos.
But we must understand that the risks in the consumption of medications and food do not lie exclusively in these products.
Há riscos de outras naturezas. A falta de alimento, a fome, a falta de medicamentos, a falta de acesso a medicamentos existentes também são riscos importantes.
There are risks of a different nature. The lack of food is a risk, and the lack of access to medication is also a risk.
E há riscos relacionados ao consumo dos produtos fabricados em qualquer parte do mundo. Recentemente tivemos um caso importante com imiglucerase.
And there are risks inherent in the consumption of products from anywhere in the world. Recently, we had a problem with a substance called imiglucerase.
Fabricado por uma indústria conhecida no mundo todo, se chama Genzyme.
Which is manufactured by a company that is known worldwide called Genzyme.
O governo brasileiro é um dos grandes consumidores desse produto.
The Brazilian government is a large consumer of this product.
E problema de contaminação nos reatores de fabricação desse medicamento privou os brasileiros de terem acesso a esse produto.
And a contamination problem in the facilities, in the equipment used to produce this substance, made it unavailable to the Brazilian people.
Então, nós estamos falando de temas de interesse global.
So we are speaking about topics of a global nature.
E o grande desafio é encontrarmos maneiras de atuarmos para que se fale em segurança global.
And our challenge is to identify ways to work the problem as a global issue.
And that is exactly the topic that we want to move to.
Exatamente.
So if you would.
Que nós gostaríamos de falar.
E nesse sentido, esse acontecimento que envolve o açaí.
And to that effect, this incident involving açaí.
É bastante interessante.
It's very interesting.
Em 2007.
In 2007.
Foi identificada uma forma de contaminação para a doença de Chagas relacionada ao consumo desse fruto.
In 2007, a contamination was identified related to the Chagas disease through the consumption of this fruit.
E nós localizamos na região amazônica 123 pessoas com doença de Chagas, sem história de terem sido picadas pelo bicho barbeiro.
In the Amazon River region, we identified 123 people who had the Chagas disease and no history of having been bitten by the bug, the barbeiro.
E verificamos, então, que esses casos estavam associados à ingestão do fruto e uma nova forma de contração da doença.
And we further identified that these cases were related to the ingestion, the consumption of the fruit, which was a new way of transmission.
Em 2007, esse fruto já tinha um consumo muito elevado no Brasil, e já era exportado para alguns países.
In 2007, this fruit was largely consumed in Brazil, and it was already being exported to other countries.
E houve esforço muito grande das autoridades brasileiras, tanto a Anvisa em nível nacional como as secretarias de saúde dos estados e das cidades.
There was a large effort undertaken by the Brazilian authorities through Anvisa at the federal level and the secretariats of health in the state and local levels.
No sentido de identificar, rastrear e encontrar uma solução para o problema.
In order to identify, track and find a solution for the problem.
E contamos ainda com o apoio de universidades brasileiras especializadas no estudo sobre doenças tropicais.
And we also had the help of Brazilian universities that are specialized in the study of tropical diseases.
E descobrimos que a transmissão da doença ocorria quando havia o consumo in natura do fruto.
And we discovered that the transmission of the disease occurred through the ingestion of the raw fruit.
E a partir dessa identificação, houve intenso trabalho na capacitação das pessoas que colhiam e armazenavam o fruto.
And based on that, we developed a large effort to train the people who were responsible for harvesting and storing the product.
E esse processo fez com que nenhum outro caso ocorresse desde então, e com mudanças que envolveram o processo de colheita, de armazenamento e processamento do alimento.
So this, after this process was undertaken, no other case has been identified. It involved changes in the process of harvesting, storing and processing the fruit.
E esse caso, ele é muito interessante.
This case is very interesting.
Porque ele demonstra que, em muitos momentos, esforços globais serão insuficientes.
Because it shows that, in many instances, global efforts will be insufficient.
Porque são problemas localizados, são muitas vezes produtores que trabalham de maneira artesanal.
Because these are localized problems, it involves workers who work at an artisanal level.
E essa deve ser uma realidade que certamente ocorre em inúmeros outros países que produzem alimentos e mesmo medicamentos para consumo global.
And that certainly occurs on a global level in many areas that produces food and even medications for global consumption.
E a Anvisa, o Brasil, tem muita disposição para que nós encontremos.
Anvisa and the Brazilian government is very willing to find a solution for these problems.
Um caminho que permita que as agências de regulação sanitária
and to identify a way for the sanitary vigilance agencies
ampliem a sua ação
to expand their activities.
All right, and I just have to seize on this because you've just laid on the table an extremely interesting point here, which is that even though we've been talking about global food and drug safety, all of this begins and to some degree should end at the local level, unless individual countries are as expert as Brazil has shown itself to be in seizing the problem, we are going to continue to have these disasters occur. So let's go back to some of the issues that have now been put on the table. It's the capacity of local authorities to have the ample science to quickly detect issues. There has to be in place regulatory capacity in order for them to do that. There may indeed need to be comparability of legislative authority in individual countries hence the need potentially for model legislation. There also has to be cooperation across borders, obviously, among these agencies, not just the regulatory agencies, but also the police authorities as well. And technology and communication also could play a very important role. Howard, you mentioned the possibility of radio frequency identification or also the more low-tech cell phone approach. And then communication. And this point I want to stay on because we haven't talked yet about the role of public outrage and public demand of improvement of local authorities. I was struck in the background material that Lori and her colleagues prepared that the CDC estimates in 2009 there were 3,000 deaths in the United States from contaminated food and drinks alone. Not to put too fine a point on that, but that's equivalent to the World Trade Center bombings as a disaster in terms of fatality. So where is the public outrage, and can that serve as a force to push more countries along? Peggy?
Well, I think that public engagement is absolutely essential, and I think that it speaks to the fact that certainly in our country, and I think in many countries across the world, that at the end of the day, whatever your political stripe, whatever your views about government overall, there are some key functions of government that people have enormous reliance on. They want to be able to trust and have confidence that their food and water supply will be safe. They want to know that the drugs that they are taking and giving their family are safe as well. And I think for the most part, in the United States, people assume that to be true. I don't know as much about attitudes in other countries, but you know, it's something where people don't think about it until there's a problem. That's always been the challenge of public health, that until there's a problem, people take it for granted. But I think we saw with the Food Safety Modernization Act, actually, an enormous mobilization of consumer groups and advocates with industry and with other critical stakeholders to say, we have an opportunity to do better. And while the U.S. food supply, you know, is extremely safe, that 3,000 deaths a year is too many, many-fold more preventable hospitalizations, and, of course, huge preventable costs to industry as well. And so there was this galvanization that led to action, which will make a difference. But one reason why I was very excited to have this forum today is that I think people have no idea in this country and around the world about the vulnerability of things that we count on every day, food, drugs, medical devices, and other related products, and that we have a system that has big gaps in our protective mechanisms, and that it's a growing problem, and that, in fact, it is a problem that goes beyond what any one nation can do alone, no matter how well-resourced, no matter how dedicated. It is a problem that, by its very nature, requires a global alliance. In my remarks this morning, I said I think the time has come that we really need to create and formalize a global alliance of regulators that are committed to solving these problems together, to sharing information in new ways, sharing best practices in new ways, even sharing the workload in new ways, and importantly, working with industry and other stakeholders, because it is a shared responsibility that goes beyond government as well. But I think that in all of these efforts, that notion of shared responsibility and the critical central role of the consumer, because at the end of the day, it's all about serving them and protecting and promoting their health and well-being.
So on the possibility that regulatory authorities in individual countries will not all leap to the fore to take up your challenge, could we conceive of a global citizen Facebook revolution to enlighten people throughout the world about the need for these issues? Howard?
I think that would be a great way to move forward in using any technologies that are out there to get the message out. I think that we should look at the internet and the possibilities like that, although many of the individuals who are affected by this are in regions of the world where internet capabilities aren't there, which goes back to the issues of cell phones and what kind of more low-tech more simple technologies would be available. But I think it's also an issue, as the commissioner mentioned, is the need to get this message communicated and almost create a grassroots effort to make people aware of the problems that are there.
Text for safe food,
right,
for example, something like that. Director Barbano, to bring you into this conversation again, what was in Brazil, was there resistance to the various food processors or others to you as a regulatory agency wading into this? And if so, how did you overcome that?
Conflito de interesses quando se trata de regulação sanitária.
There is always some conflict of interest when we speak about sanitary vigilance regulation.
E certamente esses conflitos ocorrem no Brasil, ocorrem aqui nos Estados Unidos e na Europa também.
And certainly these conflicts exist in Brazil as they do in the US and Europe.
O importante é nesse esforço global.
It's important in this global effort.
É que se consiga observar em que grau de autonomia essas estruturas atuam nos diferentes países.
What degree of autonomy these institutions have in their own countries?
Houve no Brasil uma preocupação quando a Anvisa foi criada em que ela pudesse estar preservado o máximo possível dessas pressões.
In Brazil, when we created Anvisa, there was a concern to protect Anvisa from these kinds of pressures.
Mas é possível citar a questão dos limites para a utilização de agrotóxicos?
For example, we can mention as an example the use of agricultural protection agents.
Quando a Anvisa determina limites máximos da presença de agrotóxicos, normalmente se estabelece um conflito com os produtores dos agrotóxicos e também com os produtores agrícolas.
So when Anvisa establishes the a limit on the use of these substances, there is a conflict with the producers and the farmers.
Mas há no Brasil um sistema legal consistente que permite e respalda as decisões técnicas da agência.
But Brazil has a legal system that is consistent and supports the agency's decisions in this regard.
All right. We're now going to open this up to questions and discussion from those of you in the audience. It would be very helpful if you'd raise your hands, obviously, and identify yourself by name and affiliation, and a microphone will circulate to you. Let's start with the hand right up there. Terrific. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jean Halloran from Consumers Union, and I also work with Consumers International. I think it's very important not to be naive about the potential for a grassroots groundswell for food safety. Consumers all over the world do care, but we just saw the case in China where one of the parents of a melamine-injured child was organizing other parents and was thrown in jail. So there are limitations, particularly in some of the countries we're most concerned about for grassroots activism. I think we also need to look at, and I wonder if any of the panelists can comment, on our trade policy, because we establish trade agreements as if all other countries in the world share our values and share our regulatory systems and commitment to them. And then when we start getting substandard products in, because they have maybe even laws on the books that they don't enforce, you know, it's like, oh my goodness, what do we do? We treat it as if it's a surprise. And I wonder if we can begin factoring into our trade agreements provisions that allow us to treat other countries in terms of the reality of their safety system.
All right, which gets us into an arena of trade policy, and I don't know that we have any experts on trade policy on the panel, but Peggy, do you want to take a...
Well, you know, I certainly don't pretend to be a trade policy expert, but what I hopefully am is a public health expert, and I think that that is the principle we need to organize our actions around, and we need to make sure that citizens of any nation, rich or poor, can have access to adequate food supplies and quality food supplies, and that, you know, there's a lot more that can and should be done, and that as we think about how to respond to a globalized world in a way that helps to protect our own nation, and that is my mandate as FDA commissioner, is to promote and protect the health of the American people, I think it's critically important that I recognize and step up to the plate that if I am to do that job well, it also means that I need to, in fact, care and invest and advocate for the quality of those commodities in other nations, and that at the end of the day, we need to try to approach ways not to make every country identical in how they regulate these products, not to assume that every country, large and small, is going to have systems that look just like the U.S. FDA or other food and drug oversight entities from other countries, but that there will be some basic principles, there will be sharing of best practices, there will be efforts to proactively help build capacity through technical assistance and information sharing, and that we will work in ways that are national, regional, and global to really ensure that there's a minimum threshold of standards for food products around the world. And I think that is, you know, the goal that I bring to this.
So how much contact do you have with the U.S. Trade Representative's office or the customs folks in terms of enforcing some of these food safety or, for that matter, drug safety issues?
Well, I would have to say that I don't think at present that there is enough conversation, communication, and mutual understanding. And I think that we need, as the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, to, in fact, sit down more frequently with our counterparts, and it's something that I've engaged in. I think the danger in not having those conversations is that, in fact, decisions get made on the basis of trade and commerce that may not, in fact, factor in critical aspects of public health. And so I think it's very, very important that we make sure that the public health issues are fully understood and aired as many of these broader trade debates go forward.
And I don't suppose we have any reason to believe that other countries do this markedly differently, that there's more discussion among the trade authorities in other countries. Or is there?
You know, my sense is that for many years there have been sort of parallel tracks, and that in fact the public health issues have not been as central to the discussions as they need to be. We need to make sure that things that really matter for health, well-being, and in fact safety and security more broadly are integrated into these discussions and ultimately into our policies.
Okay, that's terrific. Let's take a question over here, please.
Hi, Eric Olson with the Pew Charitable Trusts. I had a question. One of the biggest policy challenges has been addressed a couple times, but we haven't really heard an answer. How FDA now, as I understand it, is inspecting about 1% of our imports, so 99% of the imported foods are not inspected. We've heard it's going to cost $1.4 billion for FDA just to implement the new food safety law over the next 5 years. Assuming that all the budget cuts that everyone is talking about may hit FDA and other food safety agencies, what would the role be potentially for fees on the industry to help pay for this implementation? We know in PDUFA for drugs, the drug industry pays fees to pay for the regulatory system in part. And I believe the Obama administration supported the House legislation that had fees for food safety implementation. Is that something that really might be part of the solution here, not just in the United States, but potentially more globally, to make sure that this new web of international trade in food and, frankly, in drugs, really that we get a handle on it, that regulatory authorities can inspect more than 1% of the imports and perhaps do some of the overseas inspections that are required in the new legislation?
I think there really are two overlapping issues here, and we don't want to completely put them together. One is the question of how do we implement the food safety bill, which is enormously important and does begin to get at some of the global food safety issues that are so critically important. And there's no question that the law puts forward a number of very prescriptive actions for us to take, all of which are very important and much needed, including enhancing inspectional activities. And yet, it's a unfunded mandate, as we like to say, and it does raise serious issues for us. As was mentioned in the first panel, industry cares enormously, in fact, about achieving the goals of this new legislation and strengthening food safety and, importantly, implementing the preventive focus that's part of the Food Safety Modernization Act to prevent problems from happening in the first place rather than trying to scramble after them once they've occurred. And so I do think that industry is willing to step up to the plate in terms of resources and partnership to take more responsibility and accountability for their contribution to ensuring the safety of the global and domestic supply chain. And so we really need to work on that, and we really need to make sure that the goals of the Food Safety Modernization Act can be realized in our implementation. I think looking more broadly at the circumstances of globalization and what it means for medical product and food safety, we have to recognize this isn't a problem that our nation or any other nation can inspect its way out of. It really is a problem that requires a fundamental shift in how we think about the problem and how we work together as true partners across nations and governments as well as across sectors, because the complexity of the global supply chain and the magnitude of the problem, you know, really means that we have to you know, work together in completely new ways, sharing information, sharing best practices, sharing workload. As I said before, we need, you know, really different systems that break down, you know, some of the traditional stovepipes of our different institutions to think and act in multinational coordinated ways. And I think that's a huge challenge, but it's also, I think, the only way we will achieve success. And there is a huge opportunity to do things in new and different ways because the challenges before us simply demand it.
Peggy, you used a phrase in your opening remarks that there are 20 million different lines, did I get that right, of that's all products imported into the United States that are under FDA's jurisdiction, reinforcing your point that we can't inspect our way out of this because there's no way we're going to inspect 20 million lines, and that's lines, so I assume it's multiple products in each of those lines.
You know, we can do a better job with inspection, and we need to. It's not that inspection doesn't have a role. It has a huge role, both at the borders and in the different countries where products are being made. But we have to do much more than that, and it involves taking an approach that both is much more collaborative and also much more risk-based. You know, we really need to focus on the things that will make the most difference. And assessing and monitoring risk is a dynamic, ongoing process that, again, can only be done effectively if we're really sharing information across governments and across sectors to understand the range of vulnerabilities, how those vulnerabilities may be changing, because some products may be vulnerable because of bad actors that become identified in one country or another. That information gets shared, and then we can all act on that information. Products may become more vulnerable because of environmental conditions that may actually change the risk profile and sharing information on that. And certain products are more vulnerable by their very nature. But the more we can really take a risk-based approach, the more we can really take a preventive approach, and the more we can really take a approach of true collaboration, the more progress we'll make towards our goals.
Great. Great. All right, let's go to a question right there in the middle, please.
Dan Spiegel, Covington and Burling. Turning to the World Health Organization for a moment, the program that Dr. Zucker put together, the impact program, I think we ought to say, is no longer the program that he originally designed, which was originally supported by a consensus. That consensus has, at the member state level, has broken down. And my question for Director Barbano is, could you inform us, do you know why Brazilian diplomats in Geneva have worked so hard against a WHO role that would strengthen its normative standard setting and its operational capacity to work in innovative ways to deal with drug and food safety?
Essa questão é muito relacionada ao que o Dr. Heyman comentou no painel anterior.
This issue is very much related to what Dr. Heyman alluded to in the previous panel.
A posição brasileira em relação a esse tema é muito clara.
The Brazilian position in this regard is very clear.
O que nos preocupa é que essa questão conceitual...
Our concern is that this conceptual issue...
Não pode trazer para o ambiente da preocupação com a saúde pública...
Cannot be brought to the environment of a concern with public health.
Questões de ordem de propriedade industrial.
To bring into that context issues that are of an industrial interest nature.
O Brasil tem uma lei para a produção de medicamentos genéricos desde 1999.
Brazil has a law regarding the production of generic drugs since 1999.
Tem uma lei de patentes elaborada à luz dos acordos TRIPS.
It has a patent law that has been drafted based on the TRIPS accords.
Desde 1996.
Since 1996.
E a indústria de medicamentos no Brasil, indústrias nacionais.
And the Brazilian pharmaceutical industries.
Em respeito a essas duas leis.
In compliance with both these laws.
Produz um grande volume de medicamentos que atende aos programas de saúde pública e demandas da sociedade.
Produces a large volume of medications that are for these health to resolve these public health issues and tends to the demand of the population.
E a condução do grupo Impact no tema trouxe para essa discussão.
And the impact group brought to this discussion
conceitos que poderiam levar à produção de medicamentos genéricos.
A concept that could result in the production of generic drugs
realizada sobre todo o rigor da legislação sanitária brasileira.
Based on the full rigor of the Brazilian legislation,
em respeito à lei de patentes,
with respect to the patent law,
serem considerados como produtos falsificados.
To be considered to be falsified products.
Tivemos problema de uma apreensão de medicamento utilizado como antipertensivo.
We had a problem with a medication that was apprehended for a medication for hypertension,
que foi retido no aeroporto em Amsterdã.
That was apprehended at the airport in Amsterdam.
Justamente por essa confusão de conceitos.
Because of this confusion in concepts.
Nós não podemos tratar produtos legalmente fabricados.
We cannot treat products that are legally manufactured.
Em países que têm legislações sanitárias rigorosas.
In countries that have rigorous sanitary legislation.
Como produtos falsificados.
We cannot treat these products as falsified products.
Por diferenças de compreensão em torno da, dos direitos de propriedade intelectual.
As a result of the differences in what we consider to be intellectual property.
So this gets to the issue that surfaced earlier, which is the fear that in the name of public health, trade restrictive practices will be carried out. Howard, your response to that?
My thoughts on this is that it comes back to this issue of trying to merge or couple the counterfeit medicines issue with the intellectual property rights issue. And they are truly, in a lot of just separate issues. They are both public health issues. They are both concerns. And having worked on both of them at the same time at WHO, but the fact is that a counterfeit medicine, whether it's generic, and this has come into this whole issue, generic or an R&D drug, if it's manufactured by somebody who is with intent to, with a specific intent to do harm or to try to make a profit from a medicine which is not what it's supposed to be, then it's a counterfeit medicine. And this is not an issue of a patent from generics or not. I completely agree that there are many, many products that are generic products that are completely safe, has nothing to do with counterfeits. And I think these things merging together has caused the problem of trying to move forward on solving some of these counterfeit medicines problems.
But is it realistic, given the enormous economic interest here, to think that they will ever be separated?
This is where I think it comes down to the public and all those working in this area to say we need to separate these out to a certain extent. For example, there is areas of overlap in the sense that there are issues of patents on medicines. But I think if the more we merge these together, and we have to remember from a historical perspective, while this whole issue of counterfeit medicines was being addressed at the World Health Organization, there was also the whole issue of intellectual property rights, which was moving forward. There was issues of vaccines and Indonesia and some of the issues with flu. And so all these things were sort of in the mix. And I think it's very important to tease these out. As a clinician, sometimes you sort of have to tease out one medical problem from the other, and you can look at them together, but you have to sort of separate them out at times and address them separately. And I think that until we do that a little bit, we're going to run into some problems.
And the question will be whether 20 countries could get together and do precisely that. Let's take a question all the way in the back. Been neglecting the back of the room.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ashifi Gogo. I'm the CEO of Spruxel. We provide SMS verification services with NAFDAC in Nigeria. I wanted to provide an alternative view on the first question, which is public advocacy of food safety concerns based on my experience in Nigeria. A consumer called in indicating that there was a mixture of genuine and fake medication, and information was passed on to the brand owner, who was able to take action and find the counterfeiter in the act selling fake drugs to consumers using SMS technology. So I'm wondering if sort of a hotline police tip-off style system instead of maybe a public NGO might be a way to engage consumers who are in pharmacies multiple times a week to essentially report incidents of suspicious activity in pharmacies to enhance the safety for the public.
Well, anything like that?
I'll start and others will, I'm sure, want to elaborate. Reports from consumers about the quality of their products and adverse reactions, very, very important to the work that we do at FDA, and we rely on getting that kind of information and encourage it. One of the challenges with these substandard drugs is that consumers may not recognize that they're not getting what they think they're getting, and that's one of the very serious dangers, is that you may think you're getting a drug that's treating your condition. But if you are doing poorly, you may not realize it's because the drug isn't adequate. You may think your disease is just progressing or think maybe you're on the wrong medicine. But sometimes you don't know, and that's one of the dangers. Or with malaria medications, what we're seeing is, you know, not only do our populations being treated with drugs that are inactive, but it's also contributing to the growing problem of drug resistance, because they may be being partially treated with a substandard drug, and then in fact you're creating a problem with the organism, which then means that the actual quality drugs no longer treated as well because of resistance. So they're very complex problems that can unfold as you think about the challenge of whether a person is taking the drug that they're thinking that they're taking. When it actually has a toxic component, it makes it a lot easier. Someone commented that when there's a problem that's acute, the red flags go up and you can usually respond. But when it's a chronic exposure that can be damaging or an inadequate drug, it's much harder for the consumer to always be aware. But any reports are valuable. Also, reports of what appear to be inappropriate practices in pharmacies are also very, very valuable. And I think that, you know, if we're going to be successful, we need to galvanize as much of that kind of consumer information as we can and match that to other types of information so that we can get the clearest picture that we possibly can so that actions that are meaningful can be taken.
One of the other things that WHO had started back in 07 was the concept of having some way to track and having basically through the computers a way you can go onto a map, find out, someone reports in, tap on that country, tap on that region, they have a lot of information coming back. Valeria Reggi, who was incredibly instrumental in a lot of the work on this, was trying to push that forward at that point. And I don't know where it is at this point, but that was one of the concepts of trying to do just what was mentioned, you mentioned, to track.
Is that the equivalent of a global sort of adverse event reporting sharing capacity?
Right. It was sort of the concept came from that kind of system, because that was being done for issues of flu at the time.
Perhaps somebody in the audience knows the status of that. Director Barbano.
Susan, in Brazil, in 2009, the Brazilian Congress adopted a law
que estabelece sistema de controle de rastreabilidade sobre os medicamentos.
That establishes a system to control, to track medications.
E nós estamos numa fase final de definição da tecnologia a ser utilizada.
And we are in the final stages of identifying the technology that will be used.
E essa tecnologia deve permitir que na farmácia o consumidor consiga verificar a autenticidade do produto.
And that technology will allow the consumer to verify the authenticity of the medication at the pharmacy.
Há vários outros países no mundo que já utilizam essa tecnologia.
Many other countries in the world already use that technology.
O FDA manifestou interesse em conhecer a experiência brasileira e já temos duas equipes trocando informações.
The FDA has expressed its interest in familiarizing itself with the technology, and we already have two teams exchanging information.
And what is the technology?
É uma tecnologia que se baseia num código bidimensional, tipo data matrix, impresso e a utilização de selo.
It's a technology that uses a bilateral code based on data matrix and seal.
E deve permitir a elaboração de banco de dados.
And that will allow a database to be established.
Que permite a rastreabilidade.
Which will allow for tracking the medication.
E também dispositivo para observação da autenticidade.
And some device to verify the authenticity.
E essa é uma medida que conta com todo o apoio das indústrias farmacêuticas que atuam no Brasil, tanto as multinacionais como as indústrias brasileiras.
And this has the full support of the pharmaceutical industries in Brazil, both the national industries and foreign.
Eu queria citar uma questão que acho que interessa ao evento.
I'd like to mention something that might be of interest to this event.
A Organização dos Estados Americanos conduziu trabalho que levou à criação de rede.
The OAS has created a network.
O Brasil integrou essa rede agora no final do ano e
joined the network at the end of last year.
E é uma rede que se chama Rede de Consumo Seguro em Saúde.
It is called a Safe Consumption Network in Health.
E é justamente o primeiro passo no sentido de que essa rede seja capaz de captar alertas e colocá-los no mesmo portal à disposição dos países americanos.
This is the first step to create a network that will have the capability to centralize alerts and make them available in a portal.
Eu creio que mais três meses a Organização dos Estados Americanos terá em língua inglesa, espanhola e portuguesa esse portal funcionando.
I believe that the OS will have this portal functioning within 3 months in English, Spanish and Portuguese.
And that's under the auspices of the Organization of American States. Is FDA a party to that? Do we know?
You know, I'm glad to hear that. I have to confess I don't know the details, but we try to get our fingers into any international regional activity that we can, because it really is, I think, so important to us.
So the point was made earlier that many countries will not have the capacity to use some of these technological solutions because of resource constraints. But here is Brazil, a middle-income country, putting in place what sounds like, is it a barcoding system that was put in place? So it's not out of the question that these technologies could become more useful in these countries. So perhaps we'll have some conversation about addressing those capacities.
Depois que nós fizemos as eleições eletrônicas no Brasil, o mundo passou a acreditar que nós possamos avançar em tecnologias.
After we began conducting electronic elections in Brazil, the world began to believe that we have some technology.
Okay, well, and then you can export the technology back to the United States. Okay. Question over here, please.
Hello, my name is James Tunkey, and I'm an entrepreneur as well as a director of the International Council for the Life Sciences. I just first want to congratulate the council and Laura Garrett for putting this conversation together. My question is for the panel. It doesn't seem to me that we've moved from a consideration of intellectual property rights and the private profit motive to the reputation risk, really, that is posed to government organizations in the case of failure of food safety. And I think that there's some real contrasting styles of approach to governments, both in governance of private enterprise, as we see here in the United States primarily, and governments in Brazil, which continues to really have a much more state-centric approach to drug development and production. And so if you could just speak a little bit about the policy challenges of moving from the view of one that's focused on intellectual property rights protection by private industry to one that's focused on reputation risk of food failure safeties. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, I'm unclear as to whether your question pertains to the drug safety or the food safety issue. So both? Okay. So, well, let's have at it.
I mean, at the end of the day, I think that agencies like the Food and Drug Administration and the industries that we regulate do have common purpose in that trust and confidence in the work that we do and the products in question is the ultimate goal. And that, you know, I certainly think that if you look at history, you can see that industry, in fact, does better when there is a strong, well-functioning regulatory authority. And I think that as we were working on the Food Safety Modernization Act, we saw industry's real engagement and investment in systems and a legal regulatory framework that would support their ability to maintain trust and confidence in their brands. So I think it's a hugely galvanizing principle. I don't know exactly how you frame the issues of intellectual property versus the reputational. I think often they intersect. If you have a brand name product, you want to keep that brand. But I think that you know, stepping back and just looking at the importance of confidence in the products, you know, whether they're generic drugs or brand name drugs, whether they're food manufactured by a big multinational company or at a more, you know, local community level, that still is, I think, an organizing principle, and it's where a strong but modern and I think, you know, clear regulatory approach supports the ability of industry to achieve their goal, and in fact, our interests do align. I don't know if that answers your question or not, but...
It sounds like the Chinese authorities decided to get everybody's attention by putting a few people to death. Presumably, we will come up with a more collaborative approach, as Peggy mentioned earlier. We are out of time for this panel, sad to say, but I think we've worked our way through a series of the issues that we've already discussed, whether it's the lack of regulatory capacity, whether it's differences in legislation, whether it's incapacity in terms of technology. But I think fundamentally you also heard under the surface of the comments today fundamental other lacking obstacles that we'll have to get over in order to do more in this area. One is will. It's just plain will. The country's having the will to do this. It's engendering a greater awareness among consumers in particular. And essentially, we will also eventually have to address the lack of resources being devoted to this capacity among all these countries. So join me now in thanking this panel for a terrific discussion.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.